play with things like that because there was so much shrapnel and everything around. So, okay. Let me see. Then, so we went back and forth to Austria, back to Austria, back to Berlin, back and forth. And like I said, we lost our dad in 1942. He's buried in Russia. He was wounded in Sevastopol, and he's buried in Yalta. And when my mother got this picture, you see that cross on here? She went to the neighbor just crying. She thought her husband died. As it turned out, this was a reflection of a twig. And that was 2 weeks before she was notified that he died. So it was like, it was an omen. So that's just a reflection. So here's his grave in Yalta. We lost him April the 2nd in 1942. So fast forward to, you want to, I mean, I could go on and on and on with all these stories, but fast forward to the time that the war was over. We had to make a decision. My mother had to make a decision. Here she was, a widow with four little children. At the age we were at that time, we were 3, 5, 7, and 9 years old. She wanted to get back to Berlin, which was her home. So we didn't know who was coming in. Was it the Polish people? Was it the Russian people? Was it the French? Was it the Americans? Who knew? Everybody was confused. So when we found a man that was hiding, we were living on a farm there, and he was hiding, and we found him up, you know, children, they're very inquisitive. And my brother Peter and I, we were up in the hayloft, and we found this man laying there, and he had a wound in his leg, and it was horribly infected. I remember he had that khaki color or olive color kind of a container, and there was yellow powder in. I remember him always pulling this yellow powder in this. And we used to go up into the loft, and my mother knew about it, and so did Honey. She was the farmer there. And she made some soup, and we used to smuggle the soup up. We don't know what language he spoke. We knew he didn't speak German. He could have been French, he could have been Russian, he could have been anybody. But when the Russians, I mean, when the Americans came in, and I'll tell you a little bit about that in a minute, they took him out on a stretcher, and he was jovial and laughing, so maybe he was an American. I never did find out. But when the war was over, which was sometime in May.
The 8th of May.
Okay. First of all, I want to go back a little bit because this all comes to me now. We started school. And the starting school over there, we had to have this packet that had Band-Aids in it, sugar cubes, and brandy. And we had to make... we had to learn how to put on gas masks. So all these people with these gas masks, you know, this was part of our ritual for school. And I could never remember what is my left side and my right side. I remember one time the teacher said, well, which side do you salute with? I said, this way, because we had to go to school. That was it, that was the greeting. So I always knew that was the right side. But anyway, the occupation came. We didn't know, like I said, what nationality was coming in, and it was the Americans. And of course, mother says, you don't take anything from anybody, you don't eat anything they give you or whatever, because you don't know if that's gonna be poisoned. They're your enemies. So you know how little kids are. We haven't had any chocolates, we haven't had anything like that, so. Here we were all laying down on this hillside. The highway, the chaussee was up above, and we were laying with our belly down, watching all of these trucks, and oh my gosh, and some of the soldiers were walking, and ever so often an orange was thrown out, or some chocolate was thrown out. And all of a sudden, oh my God, all we saw was teeth and eyeballs. We have never seen a black person. I know that's not funny, and we were scared. You think about it, to a little child, never seen one like that? All we saw was teeth and eyeballs and these black faces. So we thought, oh, there's got to be bad people. But they were throwing out all this candy. So here we were, probably 7 or 8 of us, laying on our belly, and it was this great big old rock, and all the weeds there, looking up there all the time, what was coming. You know, we were hiding. They could see us. We didn't think they could see us. Otherwise, why would they throw it right there? So anyway, this one kid finally opened something. I don't know if it was a Hershey bar or whatever it was, and he started eating, because we were all waiting for him to die. Well, he didn't die. So somebody else opened a candy bar, and somebody else. I did too. I don't know what I was eating. It was tasting good. It was sweet. It smelled good. Well, lo and behold, about a few hours later, when I got back home, I got the most horrible stomach ache. My mother wanted to know what I was eating, so we had, you know, I had a little dressing there, the stuff that I was carrying home, and. So I showed her what I was eating. I was eating gum. Oh. I didn't know. Nobody knew you're supposed to chew this and throw it away. Oh. And I was eating this, but it was sweet and it tasted good. So much for that. Then one Sunday morning, came all these. Everybody was plundering, the people were stealing, nobody knew what was going on, everybody was trying to survive. Here came all these trucks, flatbeds, horse-drawn flatbeds with bodies on it. It smelled, it stank so bad. But some of them were still breathing. And the Americans, the soldiers, they were there with their big jeeps, and they had a cot in front of the jeep was attached. And they were pulling all these bodies out because the farmers killed anybody and everybody that was plundering and stealing from them. So some of them were still breathing, so they pulled them out. And there was this Brunnen, which is a
well.
Yeah, it's kind of like a little creek comes in, and then there's a great big trough. And then it runs back out over here. And in this trough, every cow, every horse, everybody drinks from this. So they pour them over there. I remember that so vividly. And they poured the water over their faces, and they gave them something to drink. And then they strapped them on these jeeps and drove them away. We heard later on that they saved some of them. What else can I say on this particular issue? Anyway, and getting back to that man that we found up in the loft, in the hayloft, they put him away. I mean, it took him away, and he was laughing, so maybe he wasn't American, I don't know. Yet, my mother, the war was over. She's from Berlin. She has 4 little children. She's a widow. At the time, we were 3, 5, 7, and 9 years old. So she decided she'll get herself, I mean, so many of those train tracks were bombed. Some of the buses didn't run, the trains didn't run. So she got herself a covered wagon. This is just like you see in the West right here. This has the
canvas
over, thank you. And 2 horses. They're called Russian ponies. They're bigger than ponies, but they're smaller than horses. And the dark one was a female, Mädchen. We named her Mädchen because she was a little girl to us. And this was Bubchen. It was kind of a light tan colored ones. So she decided, well, I have to get back to Berlin. I have my four little children and we need to get on the road. So she took off. She had a lot of guts, I'll tell you that. So here's some of the pictures. Whatever town we came to, we had to beg for food. So we had this white enameled pot with a handle on one side and a pouring spout on the other side. And Peter and I, because we were the older ones, we went from house to house to house to house, just begging people for some food. We always had the same story, you know, we're four little children. We lost our dad in Russia. We want to go back to Berlin. My mom always stayed with the two little ones. And when we got this bucket, somebody put in a potato, somebody else put a little bit of soup, maybe some of the little gravy, or maybe some bread. And boy, Peter and I, we were so stolz. What's stolz?
Proud.
Proud. We were so proud when we had this bucket full of food to go back. And then my mother, being from Berlin and known, you know, she always dished it out. We had dishes, believe it or not. Right there are the dishes. Here are the dirty dishes, and we had no water to wash. So we ate. When we didn't get enough food, we had to steal food. My brother jumped over fences and got, tomatoes. At night, we used to raid the potato fields. Anything to do, one time we were up, my brother was up in an apple tree, and I was standing down below with my dress, and he was throwing the apples down. And this farmer came out, saw us, went back in, and came out with a big old rifle. He was going to shoot it. I was screaming, some neighbors came, and they talked him out of it. I don't know if he would have shot us, but sure enough, it seemed real to us. I got to get my water. I'm not a speaker. In fact, somebody told me if you get nervous speaking, just think anybody in the audience is sitting there in their underwear. Just close your eyes. Everybody said, I hope you have some sexy underwear. So anyway, about that one. We were refugees trying to get back to Berlin, obviously. And there was usually a curfew. You had to be off the road. I don't know if it was 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, whatever time it was. Of course, this was in the summertime. And my mother begging the farmers just to lay her children down. So when she was lucky, they said, come into the stable. And she threw some blankets down. And that's how we slept. Many times, I woke up. Because we had that's
creeping crud.
Yeah.
That's the only translation I found.
Yeah. It's like an impetigo or whatever it is, or some skin disease because of the malnutrition and no bathing facilities for months. We were walking, we were riding in the wagon, you know, here you see it again. And so many times I woke up in the middle of the night and the mice and the rats are chewing on your sores. Oh. And this is today, if I see a mouse or a rat, I'm 7 years old. I'm 8 years old. It has never left me, probably never will. My mother was also pretty ingenious because Peter, my brother, and myself, we always had to get, she gave us the command to jump out of the wagon when the horses couldn't hold it. And either going backwards, we couldn't hold it, or going forward, the brakes didn't work. So she went to a blacksmith and she had two things made, if you can imagine, a ski. Kind of goes up in front and the big old ring on it and then the chains, and it was on each side of the wagon. So when she couldn't hold, when she couldn't hold the horses to hold the wagon because it was going downhill, Peter and I, we had to jump out of the wagon. He was on one wagon, I was on the other one, and we threw it underneath there, and the sparks were flying to hold the wagon back. So that was an experience that how we never got run over is a miracle, really. Okay, what else can I tell you?
You can explain the picture in the bottom of naked kids.
Yeah. I was gonna drop this out, but it was already on.
Point yourself out.
Here we are. Finally, we got a bath. Somebody gave us a bathtub. You can see it right out here in the field. And I don't even remember what town it was, but we finally got to take a bath. Keep in mind, we had to feed the horse too. We had to get food for the horses. We had to get water for the horses. We had to get water for us. We had to, my mother always had a little burner. She called the Spiritus Brenner. What is Spiritus in English?
It's really a gas. No, not a liquid.
It's some kind of a liquid something. So when she had to cook something on the trip, you know.
Alcohol.
Is that what it was? That's what I remember. She always had that there and to cook something. And you know, when we had nothing to eat and we were so hungry. And if you think hunger doesn't hurt, I'm not talking about missing a meal, but having these extended bellies and being so hungry. She used to take cardboard and just rip it into little places, little pieces. She had that Spiritus burner there going out and warming up the water and pour this hot water over and put a little salt and pepper, and that was our meal. But I tell you, if you're hurting so bad, it made your stomach churn and your juices going, and it was sustenance, although it was not very nutritious. So this guy named Hugo Martin, we picked him up on the way. He was a soldier that was gonna go someplace, and he had our accordion here. And he said to my mother, I'm gonna help you with your four little children. And I don't know if he was with us a day or two or three, I'm not sure. But then all of a sudden he was gone, and so was my father's shoes and a coat. Oh. And you know, in those days that was like precious, you know, like that coat. Later on there were coats made for us because everything was so precious, he didn't have very much. So what else can I say? Oh, and then here you talk about one room school. This was graduation 1952. See this old burner here, this old wood stove? And I was sitting right here, right in front. So in 1952, I was 14 years old. There was no more school to be had, so you had to get out of school. My sister, who was 2 years younger, and my little brother was 4 years younger, they got to go to higher education, so I never did, because there were no books, there were no teachers, everything was... We ended up in Gersfeld in a small town. We had... Mädchen got into a stable, and she got what's called Wunschdachkrampf, which is lockjaw, I believe, in English. Mm-hmm. And we had to, my brother walked for miles to find a veterinarian, and I never forget that when he came, we were sent away, but you know how kids are. We got up in the stable, we had to watch this procedure. So here comes this guy, he took the axe, backwards, hit her over the head, and then sliced her throat. Oh. Yeah, that was very traumatic because, you know, she was part of the family. Mm-hmm. We were part of the family, you know, we were all together. So, any questions?
When you graduated from school, where was that? Did you ever make it back to Berlin?
Never did. It was a Gersfeld, we ended up in Gersfeld, a small town in the Rhone Mountains, and it was late September, early October, and my mother saw winter was coming on, and she knew she couldn't make it anymore. The wagon was just about to fall apart, and then we had to put Machin down when she had to be put down, so what chance did we have? So we stayed there, and my mother didn't get back to Berlin till 1958. And I came to this country in 1959. I got married a soldier. Guess that, American. But he spoke very good German. He was there on his third deployment, so otherwise I would have never met him, I'm sure. And my son was born in Frankfurt, so when I came to this country, he was 6 months old. And what else can I tell you?
You must have had a pretty decent camera.
I don't know what kind of camera she had.
Well, it produced good pictures.
Yeah, I don't know. This was sent.
Yeah.
Somebody else sent that. Took those pictures, those three. Yeah, here we are. Well, that trip was really something. And one of our, I had a birthday on it, and I had a birthday, and Helmut, we were with in Gersfeld then, and Peter, so we all turned a year later, a year more. And our birthday present was a piece of bread, and when we were lucky, we had a little bit of butter that some farmer gave us, usually rancid, so we put a little sugar on it if we had it. That was our birthday present. But we always had the siblings have a bite of it, because that was sharing, everything was sharing. So this is my mom, of course, with the three. The little one wasn't born yet. But questions? Nobody?
What happened to your other horse?
Well, like I said, the wagon finally fell apart, and she sold it. Yeah, she sold it.
What happened to your brothers and sisters?
Where did you end up?
Well, we outside of Linz was called Alkoven in Linz on the Danube.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was a long trip then back on that way.
Oh, yeah.
Very,
and when you think about these hills, up and down those hills, and like I said, my mother was, the little ones were in the back of the wagon, and Peter and I, we had to jump off and get that piece of iron there underneath the wheel just to keep it from going overboard.
And they used to be called brake shoes.
Well, we had the brake things too.
They were not uncommon.
She had a maid. Yeah, she had a maid. And we had, and on that trip we had to stop so many places sometimes for 2 days or what, because the horses got so many wounds from the harness that we always had to take a day or two off to heal them, and go to the apotheke to get the medicines made and find a veterinarian. And anyway.
You're mentioning the accordion. Was there music in your family?
My mother played the piano, but I didn't have that talent. My mother played the piano, yeah, so we had that little accordion.
So did the rest of the family come over, or did they stay behind when you got married?
Actually, when I was here in this country, I ended up in Omaha, Nebraska. My husband was stationed there, and my sister wanted to come, and she came a year later, and we had to sponsor her. And she lives in, I want to tell you something else. It all comes to me sometime when I'm talking. Just about a month ago, my two cousins came from Berlin to visit here. And we all sat down, and so many things we talked about that you kind of put it in the back of your mind unless somebody brings it up, some kind of words. And there were also four children. My uncle, who was in a gulag in Russia, didn't come out of the prison camp. Prison camp? No, it's not prison camp.
It's a prison.
Yeah, well, it is a prison. Till 1953, but they also had four children. So my aunt, Tante Erika, she had two children that she lost. One of them was Uwe, a little boy about 6 months old, and he died of hunger typhus. And we all sat around that table here just a month ago, and we always said, you know, we all had the same stories. I said, either he died of hunger or he died of typhus. So little did I know about it. So I went into my other room and I just typed it into Google. I thought, well, I'm just gonna try this, hunger, typhus. Guess what? Showed up hunger, typhus disease prevalent in Russia. So he died of that. And this story is so sad. The little girl, starts with an M. Monica? No. I think it was Monica. Anyway, she was about maybe 2.5 or so years old, and she was very, very ill. And her mother, Tante Erika, was on a train with her from Lübeck back to Berlin. And this child was in high fever with some kind of a horrible disease. And she was ordered. The five of us that were sitting around here at the table, my sister came from Iowa, and my two cousins from Berlin, and that was her sister, their sister. We all agreed we had the same story, so it must be true. And either she was ordered to take this child that just died in her arms and throw it out the moving train out the window, or they grabbed the child and opened the window and threw it out. So Tante Erika waited for the next stop to get out of the train when it stopped, and she walked for kilometers and kilometers trying to find this child. And she did this for several days, they said, and never found it. Never found the little girl. All she wanted to do is scratch the earth and bury that child. And it's so sad. So anyway, there's so many stories, but I could go on for days. But just
So did your brother Peter, did he stay in Germany?
My brother Peter stayed in Germany, yes, and so did my little brother Helmut.
So Helga, how many of your siblings are living?
Now just my sister and myself. Lost my brother, my older brother, he was here 3 years ago, lost him. And my little brother, this is interesting too, my little brother, Helmut, we also lost him. He died at a young age of 61 of cancer, but he was employed in Berlin at the Spandau prison, and they were guarding Rudolf Hess.
Oh, wow.
And he was hired by the British, so he was a chauffeur for the British. And if I don't know if you know about Rudolf Hess, he was one of the war prisoners. And every month there were the four allies. Yeah, the Russian, the French, the British, and the American. So everybody had it for a month. So Helmut, in 1987 or so, that Rudolf Hess died. So, and almost overnight, they totally tore down that Spandau prison because he was the only prisoners there. And I asked him why they did that, and he said they didn't want any all this publicity and all these people that want to get a piece of that history and stuff. And he said that that whole prison was torn down, was all made out of bricks, Backstein. So that was gone in a very short time. Any other questions?
Just curious, after the hills of Germany and Austria, how did you find Nebraska?
That was my husband that was stationed there.
Right.
Yeah.
But I'm saying, was it a shock to you to see flat land like that?
We have flat land over there too. We have mountains, we have flat land. Around Berlin, it's pretty flat. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any other questions? My favorite pointer.
Well, this does conclude our first program. Our second program is on October 26th, and we've had to make an adjustment because of the passing of Lloyd Olson. His wife Dorothy, thinking of others even in her time of loss, sent me a list of the notes that Lloyd had planned to speak about. And we have many memories of what everyday life was like during the time in history, some amusing, some thoughtful, and some just survival knowledge. We're looking forward to seeing you on the 26th, and I want to thank you. And before we go in and enjoy the strudel, most of you noticed this on the seat, and if you read through it, if you have any ideas, we just really think that this is a fun thing to do a couple of times in the fall of the year and get together and just have a good time. And if we don't write down these stories or in some manner keep track of them or record them in some way, we're going to lose them. So if you have any ideas or people who would like to speak, picking on you one of these days, the two of you. This is what we're looking for. So don't hesitate to fill these out and let us know how to contact you. And Charlene, are you ready for us?
Yes, I'm putting it out.
She's got the spoon and the whipping cream in.
How much shopping do we have?
Coffee